BAM, it's true.
Now, we just got done doing a video about partial sum for geometric sequences. Now we're going to move on to the infinite sum of a geometric series. And that just means we're going to pre-write this with all the additions and let the series go on forever. Now, if you want to find the sum of a geometric series, it's a pretty simple formula. It's the overall sum is equal to a sub 1 over 1 minus r. Now, this formula does not always work. It will always, pretty much always give you a number, but that number is only going to be a valid infinite sum when your r value, the absolute value of your r value, is less than 1, or your r value is greater than negative 1 and less than positive 1. We got an example up here. I'm going to do three examples for you of how this works. The first one, though, I'm just going to kind of show you with a graphical display of this series how, or not a proof, but an idea of why it's possible to have an infinite sum. So we have these values of 32, 16, 8, 4, 2, 1, 1 half, 1 fourth, 1 eighth, 1 16th, and so I have this geometric series that can be described with this equation. A sub n is equal to a sub 1, which is 32, times 1 half, because clearly all my values are getting smaller by a multiple of 1 half, are getting divided by 2, raised to the n minus 1 power. Okay, I would like to find the overall sum of all of these values. Well, I've got a geometric series and my r value is less than 1, or my absolute value of my r value is less than 1. And we have, when an n value of 1, we have, these are supposed to be counted by 4, so 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, 28, and then finally 32. So when n equals 1, we have a value of 32. When n equals 2, for a sub 2, we have 16, which is going to be right there. When n is 3, we have 8. My a sub 4 value is 4. My a sub 5 value is 2. My a sub 6 value is 1. And we can see that if I could connect these dots, which I can't because our domain is all positive real numbers, but if I could connect my dots, you would see a graph that looks like, and actually is, except for the domain's not all real numbers, exponential decay, where I'm multiplying by an r value, again, that's basically less than 1. So these values that I'm getting from this a sub n expression, my a sub n values are getting closer and closer and closer to 0. So we're going to let this sum, all these numbers add up indefinitely, but eventually I'm going to be kind of like, you know, adding by values of 0. And when what you're adding by approaches the value of 0, we're getting close to induction proofs, so this is a bit oversimplified, but at least in the geometric setting, when you have decay and your r values, you're getting close to 0 because your r value is between negative 1 and 1, then when you try and find the infinite sum, you will be able to find the infinite sum because ultimately you're going to be effectively adding by 0. These values are going to become infinitely close to 0, and thus the overall infinite sum is going to become infinitely close to some particular value. Let's see if we can guesstimate what this is going to be. We have 32, 42, 48. 48 and 8 is 56. Now we're at 60. Now we're at 62, 63, 63 and a half, 63 and 3 quarters, and then so on as these fractions get smaller. I can't do the common denominators in my head quite so quickly. So let's see what that actual infinite sum is. S is equal to a sub 1, which is 32, over 1 minus r, which is going to be 1 half. And we have 32 over 1 minus 1 half, which is 1 half. We're going to flip that denominator up and make that division of 1 half appear as, and it is, a multiplication of 2 over 1. So my infinite sum is going to be 64. Pretty simple process, but again, it's such a simple formula, it kind of want to, at least to some degree, explain why that's occurring. We have a decay situation. Our A sub n values are approaching zero, and such as we add through the rest of this infinite series with the geometric setting and the R value being between negative 1 and 1, this special setting shows up where we end up effectively adding by zero, and thus our ultimate sum is not going to ever actually technically be 64. It's just going to approach 64 as it, much as a limit does. And if I could connect the dots, and just forgive me to allow me to do this here, way back and very early into pre-calculus, we talked about graphing rational expressions. And in that discussion, we were talking about horizontal asymptotes, how y values could approach a particular value as x approaches infinity. So it's not the first time in this class that we've talked about limits, and that's what this 64 is. The overall sum, the infinite sum, is going to become infinitely close to 64, to, you know, close enough to eventually we just sort of round it off and say, okay, it is approaching 64, the infinite sum is 64. Let's take a look at a couple more examples. Now, we're going to start these last three examples out and be done. We've got two non-examples, and we have another one that, you know, will actually work out and give us a valid infinite sum. I've got two non-examples here because I'm trying to I'm really to emphasize to you that this formula only works when your when the absolute value of your R is less than 1. However, very often, you know, this will pretty much, unless R is equal to exactly 1, this will give you a number. You just need to realize that it's not necessarily a valid answer. Here we have a very simple, again, infinite series, geometric series. We're doubling all of our numbers, and we're adding, instead of adding by numbers that are approaching zero with the decay issue, are, well, it's not an issue, it's a good thing with infinite sums, but here our values are getting bigger by a value of 2. So our R value here is equal to 2, which means there is no infinite sum. If you keep adding by bigger and bigger numbers, the overall sum is not going to become infinitely close or settle down to one particular value. It's just going to keep getting bigger. Now, what if you didn't catch that? Well, you would work out the formula S is equal to A sub 1 over 1 minus R, which is 2. That becomes 1 over negative 1, which gives you an answer of, you know, negative 1. How are you going to add a bunch of positive values and get a sum which is negative? It's impossible. It's not going to happen. Whereas here, we have 1, negative 2, positive 4, negative 8, positive 16. So now we're multiplying by negative 2. Again, an R value that is outside the range of negative 1 to positive 1. My values are kind of getting bigger and, you know, infinitely smaller at the same time, or negative, and we're not going to get a, you know, an overall sum there either. So what would the answer look like from your formula? Would it be so blatantly obvious that it's wrong? As, you know, this idea where we have a bunch of positive numbers adding to a negative sum, which is impossible. Well, here, S is equal to A sub 1 again, which is 1, over 1 minus R, which is negative 2. That is going to be 1 over 3, which supposedly is the answer. And again, this might be a bit more believable. I'm not exactly sure how, but at least we don't have a bunch of positive numbers adding up to a negative sum. But neither one of these are valid because we have R values that are outside the range of negative 1 and 1. So just because you get a number from this formula doesn't mean, well, this formula doesn't mean that it's a valid answer. Do not use this when the absolute value of R is anything other than less than 1. Okay, we've got a bunch of fractional values here. We know it has to be geometric because we're alternating between positive and negative answers. You would have seen this this example if you were watching all my videos, but just in case you haven't, you take a sub n and divide it by a sub n minus 1, or just basically any term in the geometric series that, you know, we're checking to make sure it's geometric, and divide it by the previous value. So negative 16 over 27 divided by 8 over 9, We're going to flip that denominator up and make it 9 over 8. The 9 and the 27 cancel out to be 3. The 8 and the 16 cancel out to be negative 2. And we get a ratio of, after all this cancellation, of negative 2/3, as I have noted over here. So, if you're not sure if this is geometric, you can't just check one ratio. You have to do it two or three times to make sure you keep getting the same answer. But we will. So, how do we find the infinite sum of this infinite geometric series, or of this geometric series? Well, again, one last time, it's s equals a sub 1, which is 8 ninths, divided by 1 minus r. Our value is negative 2/3. We're going to let those negatives cancel each other out. We're going to find common denominators. In other words, write that 1 as 3 over 3, and we get 8 over 9. Divided by 3 plus 2 is 5, over a common denominator of 3. We're going to flip that denominator up. Yep, just making sure. The 3 and the 9 will cancel out, giving you 1/3. And we've got 8 times 1, which is 8. We've got 3 times 5, which is 15. And we got our last example done. I'm Mr. Chiru.
Hey,
go do your homework.